You keep talking about burning the rainforest. Have you done a lot of research showing burning of the rainforest?
Yeah, a lot of the research that I did was talking about burning the rainforest and how they are burning the rainforest.
And the purpose of burning it is for what?
You know, that's a good question. I don't know exactly why they're burning it, but I can imagine they would burn it and then they would take one of those, contractors and just and just take all of the trees away.
Okay, so if I told you all of that's BS, and that's not what's really happening.
Really?
The real story is that they're pulling millions of trees a day out of the rainforest, literally. And I could show you footage that the burning is going on is only when they are plowing up the stumps and the roots to burn off the residue so they can...
Oh, that makes sense.
...start new crops. But the real thing is the palm oil, the teak wood, all of the stuff like that, baboon's teeth. That's why baboons are nearly extinct. They're being overhunted.
Are you serious?
For their teeth and other body parts, yeah. The rhinoceros for the tusks, that's why there's only one left. Because, you know, it's more important to have your tusk than you live here. How do you feel about all of that? Now that you know that it's not about just burning, it's about pilfering and raping the rainforest.
So, I do have a question. When you say that they're chopping down the trees and they're taking the teeth, what exactly are the teeth used for?
Teakwood.
Oh, teakwood.
Teakwood, palm oil.
Oh.
Making cabinets, chairs, furniture, houses. People in China want the expensive teakwood. It's all about my chair is more important than your air.
Right. Exactly. Do not trade the chair for the air. I think that's crazy. There are other alternatives in creating furniture than fancy teak wood. I mean, that teak wood is helping you breathe, so you don't want to sit on it because once it's made into a chair, that's not going to help you breathe anymore. And so you shouldn't destroy rainforest trees for the products. You should just let them be so everyone can breathe and be alive. Don't chop trees down for that.
Do you like mocha?
Do.
Chai?
Yes.
Where does that come from?
The rainforest.
So you can have your chai. Does that mean we've ripped up the rainforest? Which is more important, the air or the chai?
The air. I can live without my chai tea. I mean, my coffee comes from the rainforest too, but you don't have to destroy plants for coffee. And mocha is made from coffee, but. You can live without your chai. I'm sure there's some other thing that can be created to make that flavor.
So, what's the solution?
The solution is to join an environmental awareness group and group up with people. Use a ton of recycled paper products. You should get a group together and pledge not to destroy the rainforest and plant trees. Plant a ton of trees. Plant one in your backyard. Help preserve the rainforest.
For the person who doesn't have a lot, which is 99% of the world,
right?
What can I do? I'm just one person.
You can do a lot. What you say to other people passes on. And you can buy a tree and you can plant one, or you can just join a group. Get a group on Facebook. I mean, write a letter to your government. There is so much you can do. And just by telling someone else that you're going to do that and sharing this information, that's going to encourage someone else to do the same thing. I'm sure everyone wants to live in the next 5 years. And if we don't stop this, that's what's going to happen.
Are you a tree hugger?
I'm a tree hugger.
Are you a fanatic?
A fanatic? I mean, I'm definitely passionate about the rainforest and the products that it has that helps us, and you know, we can breathe from the rainforest, from every tree in it. And so I think the rainforest is a beautiful place and that doesn't need to go away.
So even if it's buying a movie ticket or buying a tree or a seed or stopping someone from knocking on a tree, does everyone have a way to help?
Everyone definitely has a way to help. Just plant a tree and you're already helping.
So what message do you want to send to big business about their products that people are using that are destroying the earth?
You won't have that business in another decade if you don't stop selling the teak wood and a lot of the fancy wood furniture, because everything in the rainforest is going to disappear, and we're not even going to be able to do the things that we're doing now because we won't have the energy resources that we need.
If they're true about the meltdown and flooding up to levels of 250 feet above sea level currently, being the new floor for the sea, obviously Los Angeles is gone. What does that do to your future travel and living plans?
You can't travel anymore.
Okay. Any other thoughts that you would like the world to know about the film, you, the forest, anything we forgot? What's your message?
My message is to take care of this world that you live in, because it's been so good to us and we need to give back.
Do you have any hard feelings about prior generations setting your generation up for such a possible short life expectancy?
I think they were being very selfish and they weren't thinking about it. I mean, that's their kids that are going to live in future generations. And that, I mean, it's very selfish of what they did, and they were not thinking about it, and there was no wisdom in the decision making. But I know that our generation now can do something. So if we all pledge together, we can save the rainforest.
Parting shots?
Hmm?
Any parting shots?
Of
any
what?
Other parting shots, parting thoughts?
Anything
you had researched you wanted to point out about a tiki fly or this thing or whatever got your eye that we may have forgotten to talk about?
A lot of it, well, my mom had breast cancer, and so...
Do you want to talk about that? You're more than welcome
to. Yeah.
Okay.
So my mom is a breast cancer survivor, and she would not have made it without the medicine that was provided in the rainforest. So it's not just, you know, saving people, it's saving moms and dads and brothers and family and close friends. And without those resources, my mom would not be alive today.
That was your best piece yet.
Yeah.
That was your best piece yet.
I mean, God too, but God provided the resources, you know? So it's just, yeah, it's crazy. She went through 8 rounds of chemo, lost her hair. My dad had to shave her head. Then they thought she had lymph node cancer. And so my whole story about coming out here, being an actress, it's kind of like, it wasn't even supposed to happen. Like, I wanted to be an actress. I'm from Alabama. My mom had cancer. And so about 2 years later, they thought that she was going to be okay. And then they told her she had less than a year to live. And she went to all my brother's football and baseball games. So she came out here with me for 3 months just to spend time with me and to see me do what I love. And then we went back to Alabama, and they were like, you know, spend time with Savannah because they're the older brothers and I'm the baby. And so then they're like, oh, well, you don't have less than a year to live. You're actually cancer-free. And she's like, what? And so we already started this thing of me coming out here. And so that's how it all started.
That's when I met you?
No.
You had just started coming out?
That was 2009.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it just after we had met.
Yeah.
You've done that before. Wow. I know all this part of the story. I don't know.
It's crazy. I haven't really told a lot of people, but...
How does that feel?
Well, it's crazy because she never told me she had less than a year to live. So I thought, you know, this whole acting thing was, I mean, they were serious about it, but if she were to die, it would have never happened. God forbid my mom dies, but she lived through it. And then she's like, oh, well, you know, I made a commitment to my daughter that we would do this. And so my parents were supportive. And so then we actually started coming out here and I got training and everything. And then they saw that I was very passionate about it. And so then I booked Lost in Corona Minds. And I almost got Are You Smarter Than a Fifth Grader? I was in the top 10. And she was crying because she was back home. And she was at another checkup for cancer because she wasn't 5 years cancer-free yet. I think she was like 3 years cancer-free. But she used to have severe anxiety about it. And she was so nervous and she was happy for me. That I got a call back for Are You Smarter Than a Fifth Grader. Then she went home and she thought she wasn't doing well. And my dad was out here with me and she's like, you just got top 10. she was crying. She's like, I'm so glad I get to see you do this, you know? Because, you know, a mom or a parent always wants to see their kids succeed in life. And, you know, she didn't know she's going to make it, so she was just happy that I was booking things and up things. Yeah.
Hang on one second. Dad?
Put your head in for a second, please. Because I'm not swimming here alone anymore.
Savannah, take a little step that way.
If you could step on camera with Savannah and say that we have your and her consent to use this in all formats into the next 17 generations that may survive on this planet if they pull their head out of their ass, it would be appreciated. She's rolling so you can stay.
And I think it's this camera will up.
You have my permission to use Savannah's footage in this documentary film you're producing in whatever way you seem appropriate.
And you would be her father, I'm presuming.
He has my nose. Well, I have his nose.
Are you her daddy or her sheena daddy?
He's my
daddy.
Daddy.
Okay. And she loves you. She's been very clear about this.
No, I'm kidding.
Yes.
You've been very clear. If you want to take a seat, we'll finish up with her. You can
watch all my children. She's one of them. Yeah.
That's what
all my children was your television show.
Okay,
just see.
Okay, a little step back this way and a little step forward, please.
So,
this is yours.
No, I'm not sitting at all. Okay. Because getting up and down hurts too much. Then I have to get back up again. Any other personal stories like that you want to share in parting thoughts, because you really did really good stuff there.
Oh.
Are there any other little miracle stories of those tie-ins to the rainforest and family moments that might make other sense to share or not? I'm not trying
From
to invade into
research,
a personal space.
The thing that I really connected with was the cancer.
Mm-hmm.
But I couldn't really find a whole lot beyond the medicine, which is really important, and the fresh water supply, unless there are any more facts.
There are. 40% of the Earth's oxygen comes from the rainforest.
Right.
Minor detail. It's actually higher than 20. You said 20% of the water?
Or one-fifth.
It's actually almost a third of the fresh water on the planet.
Oh.
Yeah, their numbers were off.
What website was that?
Yeah, but you know, what's 20% versus 33%? You know, it's just a little more.
13%.
Yeah, glass half full or glass flooding all over the place. So the other fact is that on the medicines, of what we know so far, it's about 25 to 30% of all pharmaceuticals and medicine stuff. And we've only tapped into 1% of what's there so far. We don't even know what the other 99% is because we're too busy killing it before we can discover it. So those are the real facts that they haven't let out yet that we're letting out in this film. So with that information, now what do you want to think about?
So I say that if we have only 1% of the rainforest medicines that we've tapped into, the other 99% can cure future disasters and devastations. I mean, look at the swine flu. Malaria. I mean, there's so many diseases out there. I had a friend whose mom, there's only five diseases. Only five women in the world got this one type of cancer, and she died from it because they didn't have a cure. So what if a medicine or a plant in the rainforest had that cure, and many other women, more than five, get it in the future? That you're killing people for selfish reasons, because you want a chair made out of mahogany teak wood. Harsh.
Sure. And unfortunately, that's what it's about. People getting chairs and special drapes and, you know, this or that made out of this special thing. There were only so many special things there to begin with.
Exactly.
So, you know, there were only so many rhinoceros tusks we could take before we got down to the one male left. So,
there's only one male left.
If we make it beyond this Armageddon that they're talking about, if it's not all real, if we make it beyond it, there's still a lesson to be learned just from the extinction alone.
Right.
How do you feel about the possibility that the future, if you have children, will be, look at the animals that used to be here, like the dinosaurs. How does that feel?
Well, we only know dinosaurs from the bones that we put together. We don't know if it was actually what the dinosaur looked like, which I'm pretty sure.
Oh my god. I gotta tell you, I've never seen that ever happen before.
Really?
No.
Oh.
No, it just all, yeah.
It is.
Sorry.
It's okay.
If it weren't for bad luck, there's no luck at all. You know that song.
So you're saying in 5 years from now, if we don't stop, there's
they're saying, and the testimony that we got from the ambassador, he said 5 years, 10 tops. It's 5 years to bio meltdown if we don't stop